Hello friends, this is Haseeba. Welcome to today's session on two-channel queuing system. In the last session, we have seen about what is simulation, what is system, what are its components of a system, and a little bit insight about single-channel queuing system. Right. So under single-channel queuing system, we have discussed two types of problems. The first problem was they will give the random numbers and you have to create the inter-arrival time random digit assignment table, and one more is service time random digit assignment table, and then you have to construct the simulation table. And one more problem we saw where they directly inter arrival time and service time were given, right? So we were able to develop our simulation table directly. So in today's class, we'll be studying about two channel queuing system. A system with two servers, right, or a system where two servers are involved is called as a two channel queuing system. So the first server name is Abel here, and the second server is called as the Baker, right? So that is why this two-channel queuing system problem is also called as Abel-Baker call center problem, right? So under this Abel-Baker call center problem, there are two servers, right? Abel and Baker, out of which Abel is considered to be more efficient. That means always we have to check for Abel. If Abel is busy, then only we will go to Baker, right? So Abel is more efficient. If both are busy, then the customer has to wait in the queue, right? If both are available, then he has to go for the Abel only, right? So let us solve one problem, right? So they will ask you like this. If at all Abel is busy and Baker is free, then only the customer can go to Baker, right? So consider a computer technical support center where personnel take calls and provide service. There are two people, Abel and Baker. Abel is more experienced and provides a service faster than Baker, right? So whenever we have a call, right? So who takes the call? Abel takes the call. If both are idle, Abel takes the call. If at all Abel is busy, then only we'll go to Baker, right? So if both are busy, then the personnel has to wait in the queue, right? Fine. Develop a simulation table for the call center problem for 10 customers. Right. So here we have to develop a simulation table for 10 customers. So inter-arrival distribution of the calls will be given. So the time between arrivals probability is given. Service distribution here, since we have two servers, so we will have two service distribution table. One service distribution table for Abel, one more service distribution table for Baker. Right. And they have given random digits for arrivals and random digits for service time. Right. So this you have to remember. If Abel is free, that means when the system starts, both are idle, right? Who picks the call? Abel picks the call, right? So if Abel is free, then Abel will only pick the call, right? So if at all Abel is busy, then only Baker picks the call, right? So if both are busy, then the person or the customer has to go for wait state, right? So that means he has to go and he enter the queue. So you know, the solution goes like this. First, we have to create the random digit assignment table for inter-arrival time. Right, so what are the columns? We will write inter-arrival time, probability, cumulative probability, and random digit assignment. Right, so take the values which are given in the table. So here we have inter-arrival time as 1, 2, 3, 4, probability is 0.25, 0.4, 0.20, and 0.15. Right, so copy this inter-arrival time 1, 2, 3, 4, probability 0.25, 0.40, 0.20, and 0.15. So cumulative probability, how do we write cumulative probability? The first value of the probability will be written as it is. And to write the next value, what we have to do? We have to add the values. So 0.25 plus 0.4, I will get 0.65. 65 plus 20 is 0.85. 0.85 plus 0.15 is 1.0. Right? So just add the next probability value so that you can get your cumulative probability. Right, so then for random digit assignment, since it has two places, right, so what we have to do, we have to take two digits. Always random number starts from 1, right? So 1 to 25, the next number will be 26 to 65, this number will be 66 to 85, and this is 86 to 00. Next, we have random digit assignment for service time of Abel, right? So we have to create a random digit assignment table for the service time of Abel, right? So just to copy the service times which are given for Abel, right? So service time given is 2, 3, 4, 5, and probability is 0.3, 0.28, 0.25, and 0.17, right? So just take those values, and in the same way as we did cumulative probability for IAT, we have to do cumulative probability for service time of Abel, right? So the first value, write it as it is. So we get 0.30 plus 0.28 is 0.58, 0.58 plus 0.25, 0.83. 0.83 plus 0.17 is 1.0. Then we have random digit assignment. So random digit assignment always starts with the number 1. So 1 to 30, 31 to 58, 59 to 83, 84 to 00. The same way we have to construct random digit assignment table for service time of baker, right? So service time of baker, right? So it will be given in the question. So 3, 4, 5, 6, copy the same values, copy the probabilities, whatever is given in the question, construct the cumulative probability and the random digit assignment, right? So the last step is we have to develop the simulation table, right? So to develop the simulation table, they have told that we have to develop a simulation table for 10 customers, right? So write the customer number here, 1 to 10, right? So then we have to write the random numbers or random digits for inter-arrival time, right? So if you see the random digits for inter-arrival time, they would have given 9 numbers because for 10 customers, we will have 9 numbers, right? So we'll count here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9. Because for the first customer, the inter-arrival time will not be there, right? So that is because he is the first one to enter the system. So we'll put dash for the first customer and remaining 9 numbers have to be written in this column, right? So inter-arrival time for the first customer is not there, right? So then how to find the inter-arrival time? We just have to refer the random digit assignment table for inter-arrival time, right? So for 30, what is the inter-arrival time? We'll go back to the table where we have constructed, right? So where is 30? 30 comes between 26 to 65, right? So we are seeing the random digit assignment table for inter-arrival time. 26 to 65, we get 30. So for 30, the inter-arrival time is 2, right? So we will write for 30, the inter-arrival time is 2, right? So in the same manner, for all the random digits, you have to write the corresponding inter-arrival time. Then the next step is to calculate the arrival time. So initially the arrival time of the first customer always is considered to be 0. How to find the value of this? It is 0 plus 2, 2. 2 plus 4, 6. 6 plus 2, 8. 8 plus 1, 9. 9 plus 1, 10. 10 plus 3, 13. Right? So you have to add the next value. Right? So 90 plus 4, 23. Then you will be getting your arrival time. Right? So then we have one column which is called a server chosen. Right? So we have two columns for Able and Baker. Right? So write the two rows first, Able and Baker. For Able, we will write the random digit for service time, right? So then time service begin, time service end. Same columns have to be written for Baker also. Random digit for service time, time service begins and time service ends. Then we have the other two column, right? So which is to calculate whether the server is idle or not, right? So that is caller delay and how much time the person spends in the system, that is time in the system, right? So you have to remember all these columns for the simulation table. Right, so coming to the first customer, right? So when the first customer comes or the first caller comes, right? So which server will be chosen? Because both are free, Able is chosen because Able is considered to be the most efficient. Always Able is chosen, right? So select Able, random digits for service time. They have already given the random digits here for the service time, as we can see, right? So the totally how many numbers are there? They will give 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. 10 numbers because we have to develop the simulation table for 10 customers, right? So write the random digits, whatever is given here for the service time, right? So since the server is chosen is Able, we have to see what is the service time for this particular random digit, right? So I will go here for 65. I'll go to the table service time of Able, right? So for 65, what is the service time? Service time is 4. You have to see the corresponding row, right? So after seeing the corresponding row, come back and write here 4. Right? So the time service begin, what is the arrival time of the customer? He comes at 0, so service starts at 0. What is the service time he wants? He wants only 4. So 0 plus 4 is 4. Time service ends at 4. What is the status of Baker? Baker was idle, right? Because this is the first caller who has come where both were idle. Since Able was more efficient, Able picked up the call, right? So Baker is idle. Caller delay, there is no caller delay, right? Because he is the first person to enter the system. What is the total time spent in the system? He spends only 4 minutes, right? So we write 4. Next. Come to the second customer, right? So second customer comes at arrival time. You have to always check the arrival time. So second customer comes at arrival time 2. When the service is ending, the service ending of Able is 4, right? So that means at 2, who is busy? Able is busy, right? So who is free? Baker is free. So which is the server we have to choose? We have to choose Baker now, right? So what I will do, I'll be choosing my Baker as my server, right? So Baker is chosen. So why Baker is chosen? Because Able is busy. So you have to write the status of Able first. Able is busy. That is why Baker is chosen, right? So then What is the random digit? The random digit is 15, right? So whatever random digits they have given, same values we are taking here, random digits for service time, right? So this 15 value we have to see in Baker's table now, right? So we will go to random digit assignment for service time of Baker. For 15, what is the service time? The service time is 3, right? So for 15, the service time is 3, right? So for 15, the service time is 3, right? So when the service will begin, what is the arrival time? The arrival time of the second customer is at 2. So service will begin at 2. He needs 3 minutes. So 2 plus 3 is 5, right? Is there any caller delay? No, right? So as soon as he arrived, he was served, right? Because we have two servers here. If at all we had single server, then he has to wait because the server will be free only at 4, right? But since we have one more server who is Baker, right? So this person will not wait and he will get service at that particular time, right? So caller delay is 0. The time spent in the system is 3, right? So moving to the next one, what is the arrival time? Arrival time is 6. When the service is ending for Baker Abel, it is 4. Service ending for Baker is 5. That means at 6 arrival time, both Abel and Baker both are free. We have to always check the service ending time and the arrival time, right? So at 6, both are free, right? But who is chosen? Abel is chosen, right? So we'll choose Abel, right? So we have 25. So for 25, if I see the service time distribution table of Abel, right? So if I go back and if I check what is for 25, for 25, I will get the service time as 2, right? So you have to write the service time as 2. Then at what time service will begin? What is the arrival time? Arrival time is 6. So it will begin at 6. So 6 plus 2, the service will end at 8. What is the status of Baker? Baker is idle, right? So we don't have caller delay here. So the total time spent in the system is how many? He is spending only 2. Because his service time is 2, he is coming at 6 and he is leaving at 8, right? So the same way we have to solve the problem completely, right? So next, once again, we will go back. We'll check what is the arrival time. Arrival time is 8, right? So at 8, who is free? See, at 6, Abel is free, right? And Baker is also free. But who will be chosen? Abel will be chosen, right? So next, see, we have 12. What is the arrival time? Arrival time is 9. That means Abel is busy here. So who will be chosen? Baker will be chosen, right? So next, what is the arrival time? Arrival time is 10, right? So at 10, we can see that Abel is also busy, Baker is also busy because Abel will be free at 12, Baker also will be free at 12, right? So at 10, both are busy. So what we have to do, the person has to wait, right? So this particular person will have a caller delay by 2 minutes. He will wait for 2 minutes. Then who will take the call? Abel will take the call because Abel will be free by 12, right? So the same way we have to complete the Abel-Baker problem. So in the next unit, right? So which is there in your first module is concepts in discrete event simulation, right? So there are so many concepts under discrete event simulation. These are nothing but the definitions what we will be using for our problems, right? So the first definition is about system. What is a system? We know that it is a group of components which interact with each other in order to accomplish some task, right? So that is the same definition of system. Model, it is an abstract representation of a system. Then we have system state. System state means what? A collection of variables which are basically required in order to describe the system at a given point of time, right? So that is called as the system state. Next we have entity. What is an entity? An entity is nothing but an object of interest in a system. An object of interest in a system is called as the entity. What is attribute? Property of an entity. Next I have list. Right? List is nothing but the collection of associated entities in some logical fashion. That means there is some procedure, right? So in the way how they will be interconnected to each other. That is what we mean by list, right? So then we have event. Event is nothing but an instantaneous occurrence in the system. That means sudden change in the system, we call it as an event. Then we have event notice, right? So event notice is nothing but it is the record of an event to occur, right, at current time or so at some future time, right? So event notice is nothing but it is a record. Record of what? It is a record of an event, right? So it tells that the event will occur now or the event might occur at some future time. Then we have event list, right? So event list is nothing but a list of event notices that occur at some future time, right? So this event list, we call it as the FEL. FEL stands for future event list. Then I have the definition of activity. What is an activity? An activity is nothing but the duration of time of specified length, right? So delay is nothing but duration of time of unspecified length because we don't know, right, till what length we will be having the delay in the system. Then we have a clock, right? So clock is nothing but a variable which is representing the simulation time, right? So these are the 12 definitions, what you have to remember. If they ask, explain the concepts in discrete event simulation. So then coming to our next algorithm, so now very, very important, repeatedly asked exam question, right? So which is event scheduling algorithm, right? So one more name for event scheduling algorithm is time advance algorithm. So there are different steps in this event scheduling algorithm. The first step is what we have to do. We have to remove the imminent event or the remove the event notice for the imminent event from the FEL, right? So what is this imminent event? Imminent event is nothing but the first event which has occurred, or it is called as the current event. So remove the imminent event from the list. That is the first step. Step two is advance the clock from T to T1, right? So you have to advance the clock to the imminent event time. That is from T to T1. Step three is execute the imminent event, update the system state. Step three, we have to execute the imminent event and update the system state. Step four is we have to generate the future events. Step five, update the cumulative statistics and counters, right? So in this event scheduling algorithm problems, we'll be calculating different types of statistics like busy time of the server, maximum queue length, right? So what are the number of departures? How many customers have left the system? What is the average response time, right? So how much time the customers have spent, like 5 minutes, 4 minutes, right? So all those things. There are few statistics which we have to discuss here, right? So we have to update the statistics. So what we'll be doing first, the first step is we will be removing the event, imminent event from the list, right? Then advance the clock from T to T1. Then third step is execute the imminent event and update the system state, right? So then we have to generate the future events. That means I have to update the future event list and I have to update my cumulative statistics and counters. So in order to understand this event scheduling algorithm, right? So we will categorize, well, we have two types of events, right? Arrival event and departure event, right? So we have a flow diagram for arrival event. This is very, very important, right? So arrival event flow diagram. So arrival event flow diagram, it tells that first arrival event occurs at time T, right? So when I have an arrival event, I have to check whether my server is free, right? Or it is busy, right? So is LS of T equal to 1? That means if it is busy, LS of T is nothing but load server at a time T, right? Check the load of the server at a time T. If it is equal to 1 means the server is busy. If it is not equal to 1 means the server is free. Right. So if it is no, the answer is no. That means the server is free. What I have to do? I have to set the server to busy state. Right. So I will set LS of T equal to 1. Once I make the server busy, right. So what I will do? I will generate the service time S star. Right. For that particular customer, for what is the service time? I will be generating the service time S star, schedule new departure event, which is a T plus S star. Right. So once I get a customer, right, I have to schedule the service time for that particular customer, right? So after scheduling the service time, you have to generate the inter-arrival time. That means in order to schedule the next arrival, you have to schedule the first departure and you have to schedule the next arrival. If at all the server is busy, right? So what you have to do? We have to send that particular customer to the queue, right? So I will write it as increase LQ of T by 1, right? So LQ stands for load queue, right? So load queue of T by 1. So then what we are doing, we are generating the inter-arrival time, right? So inter-arrival time is represented by A star, right? So I will schedule the next arrival, right? By adding the inter-arrival time to the current time. That is a T plus A star, right? So then we have collect the statistics, return the control to time advance routine, right? So here LS of T stands for load server at time T. So LS of T is equal to 1 means server is busy. LS of T is equal to 0 means server is idle. So these are the two status of the server. Either it is idle or it is busy, right? So all this LS of T, LQ of T, right? So all these we call them as the system state variables, right? So if server is busy, LS of T is equal to 1, then we will load the queue, right? By increasing the queue by 1. So LQ of T will be increased by 1. What is A star? A star is nothing but inter arrival time for the next customer. What is S star? S star is nothing but the service time of the current customer, and we have to schedule the first customer or the current customer's departure, right? So A star is nothing but we are scheduling the arrival of the next customer, right? So these points you have to remember. The next type of event what we have is a departure event. So departure event, it occurs at a time T, right? So for the departure event, I'll check the queue. Is LQ of T greater than 0, right? So if it is greater than 0 means what? That means people are there in the queue, If it is greater than 0, I have to reduce LQ of T by 1. Reduce LQ of T by 1, generate service time, S star schedule, new departure event. Right. So if at all still people are there in the queue, right? So I will take that particular person from the queue and I will schedule his departure. Right. So I will generate the service time S star and I will schedule the new departure event, which is T plus S star, collect the statistics and return control to time advance routine. Right. So if at all, right, if at all LQ of T is greater than 0 is false. Right. So if it is false means what? That means the server is, that means nobody is there in the queue, right? So if nobody is there in the queue, I have to set my server to be go to idle state, right? So I will set LS of T is equal to 0. And I will come back, I will collect the statistics and I will return the control to time advance routine, right? So we have two types of problems on event scheduling algorithm. The first type of problem is to find the busy time of the server and maximum queue length. We will find the busy time of the server and maximum queue length, right? The next type of the problem is for checkout line customers, where we will be finding out the number of departures, average response time and mean proportion time. So two types of problems will be asked under event scheduling algorithm. Let us see the first type today, right? So consider a grocery store with one checkout counter. The inter-arrival time between the customer and the service time are given in the table. IAT and ST will be given, right? So perform the simulation until the clock time is 20, right? So you have to remember that we have to stop the simulation when the clock is 20. So prepare a simulation table using event scheduling algorithm. Calculate the busy time of the server and maximum queue length. This is the first type where we will be calculating the busy time of the server and maximum queue length. In order to solve this problem, right? So first what you have to do, check the number of customers, right? So they have told that you have to develop the simulation table, right? So the number of customers are not given, right? So we can make out the number of customers by counting the service time, right? So how many service times are there? Those many customers we have to take. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 service times are there, right? So I will write 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, right? So inter arrival time is 7. So dash, I will write 3, 2, 6, 2, 4, 5. I will write 7, right? Because totally 7 values are there, right? So I will write the table for 7 customers. How to write arrival time? It starts with 0. Next one is 0 plus 3, 3 plus 2, 5 plus 6, 11, 11 plus 2, 13, 13 plus 4, 17, 17 plus 5, 22, right? So then we will have time service begins, service time and departure time. Departure time is nothing but when the service will end. So service time, how many values they have given? They have given 6 values, right? So write the 6 values starting from the first customer, right? For the 7th customer, service value is not given, right? Leave it off, no problem, right? So start from the first customer. What is the arrival time? Arrival time is 0, right? So time service begins, service will begin at 0. So 0 plus 2, I will get it as 2, right? So next, what is the arrival time? Arrival time is 3, right? So service will begin at 3. So 3 plus 5 is, I will get 8. Next, arrival time is what? 5. Right, but when the service is ending at 8 means it should start at 8, right? So it will begin at 8, 8 plus 5 is 13, right? So next to check the arrival time, it is 11, but service is ending at 13, so it should start at 13. 13 plus 8 is 21, right? So next check the arrival time is 13, but the service should start at 21. So 21 plus 4 is 25, right? So next to check the arrival time is 17, right? But the service is ending at 25. So 25 plus 5 is 30. Right, so next to check the arrival time, it is 22, but the service is ending at 30, right? So next service should begin at 30, right? But we don't have the service time, so we are not calculating the departure time, right? So like this, first you have to construct a small table where we will come to know what is the arrival time of the customer and what is their departure time, right? So this table we are constructing so that we can write our event notices, right? So how to write event notice, right? Customer one, I have the arrival time is 0, right? Departure time is 2. So A comma 0, D comma 2, right? So next customer 2, arrival time is 3, departure is 8. So A comma 3, D comma 8, I will write. Next customer 3, arrival time is 5, departure is at 13, right? So A comma 5, D comma 13. Next customer 4, what is the arrival time? Arrival time is 11, departure is 21. So A comma 11, D comma 21. Customer 5, arrival time is 13, departure is 25. Right, so arrival 13, departure is 25. Next customer 6, arrival is 17, departure is 30, right? So arrival is 17, departure is 30. Next customer 7, what is the arrival time? Arrival time is 22. We don't have the departure time, so just write the arrival time, A comma 22, right? So like this, looking at the above table, we have to write the different event notices, right? So once we write the event notice, now we can start for the construction of our simulation table, right? So in our simulation table for the type 1 event scheduling algorithm, right? So we will have the clock, right? So the next column will be LQ of T. LQ stands for load queue, right? So then we will have LS. LS stands for load server. Then we have FEL. FEL is our future event list. FEL is future event list. Then I have one column called as comments, right? So what are the statistics we have to calculate here? We have to calculate the busy time of the server and maximum queue length. Therefore, B and MQ, right? Then I have added one more column here, which is called as illustration, right? So if I write this illustration, it will be very easy for me to update the rest of the columns, right? So what you have to do is first always remember the clock starts at zero. The clock starts at zero, right? So initially the clock is zero, right? So nobody will be there in the queue. So LQ is also zero, right? Always the server status is busy, right? So because at the clock zero only, the customer one arrives, right? So at the clock zero, the server status is busy. So LS of T set it to one, right? So now we have to write the illustration, right? So at the clock zero, what happens? At the clock zero, first customer comes, right? So at the clock zero, first customer enters into the system, right? So whatever I write inside the box is nothing but the customer number of customers who are there with the server, right? So whatever I write on the left hand side is my queue. Whatever I write on the right hand side is nothing but my departure. This you have to remember, dash, it is square box. Again, I have a dash. Whatever I write inside the box, that means they are with the server. Whatever I write towards the left hand side, that is my queue. Whatever I write towards the right hand side, that is my departure. So what we do initially, the clock is zero, right? So at clock zero, what happens? First arrival occurs, right? So the first customer has come and he is there with the server, right? So what I will do is A comma zero has occurred. So take a pencil and strike out A comma zero here. Strike out A comma zero, right? So what type of event it is? It is an arrival event. So if it is an arrival event, what we have to do? We have to schedule the next arrival and departure, right? So what is the next arrival and departure? Departure is a D comma 2, arrival is A comma 3, right? So D comma 2, A comma 3, you have to remember that, right? And what is the simulation end time they have given? They have told that run the simulation till the clock time TE is 20, right? So I have to take E comma 20, right? So after writing this, who is there in the queue? Nobody is there in the queue. So I will write it as zero, right? Who is there with the server? Customer one is there with the server. That means server is busy. I will write it as one. Then I will write my FEL. What I did? Arrival event occurred, right? Then I have scheduled the next arrival and departure, right? So I will schedule the next arrival and departure, and always FEL should be written in ascending order, right? So we got D comma 2 and A comma 3. These are the two things we got. A comma 0 has occurred, right? So D comma 2, A comma 3, E comma 20. I will write it in ascending order, right? Since it is an arrival event, I have to schedule next arrival and departure. And always remember, in your FEL, what will be there? One arrival, one departure, and one end of the simulation, right? So three values will be there. So how to write the comments? Comments, you just have to write what has happened now, right? So what has happened? First arrival has occurred. First A occurred at A comma zero, right? What is the next inter-arrival time? Inter-arrival time, go back to your table, right? So what is the inter-arrival time of the second customer? It is 3, right? So check the inter-arrival time, it is 3. So write A star is equal to 3, schedule next A. A star is equal to 3, schedule next A. Right. So then what is the service time? So you have scheduled the departure of the first customer. What is the service time of first customer? It is 2. Right. Therefore, S star is equal to 2. Schedule first D. Right. So initially, the busy time of the server also is 0. The maximum queue length is also 0. Next, what we do for as per FEL, we have to remove the imminent event from the list. Right. So we will remove the imminent event from the list. What is the imminent event? Imminent event is nothing but the topmost event in your FEL. So in we have D comma 2, right? So I'll remove the imminent event from the list and advance the clock from T to T1, right? So I will go from 0 to 2, right? So what happens at 2? Departure of the first customer, right? So I have to immediately, as soon as you write the clock, you have to go to your illustration, right? So under illustration, first customer has finished his service, right? So he will move out of the system, right? So C1 will come out, right? So what type of event it is? It is a departure event, right? So I will write the illustration. Once I write the illustration, who is there at the queue? Nobody is there. Who is there at the server? Nobody is there at the server, right? Therefore, 0, 0. Since it is a departure event, what I have to schedule? If it is a departure event, I have to schedule the next departure, right? So if D, 2 is over, what is the next departure? I have D, 8, right? So strike out this. You have to schedule the next departure, which is D, 8. You have removed D, 2. What is remaining in your FEL? A, 3 and E, 20 is remaining, right? So you have to add a D, 8 to this, right? So always you have to write FEL in ascending order. Therefore, I will write it as A, 3, D, 8, E, 20, right? So what are the comments? Comments are nothing but first departure occurs, first D occurs, that is D, 2, right? So S star is what? The service time of the second customer, right? So we have seen the service time of the second customer is 5, right? So S star is equal to 5, schedule next D, right? So after this, what we have to do is we have to check the busy time of the server, right? Busy time of the server means what, right? So till what time the server is busy, right? So server started as 0, right? So till 2 minutes, it was busy, yes or no, right? Because first customer was there, right? So 0 to 2 server was busy. So I will write it as a 2. Fine. Then I have maximum queue length, right? So what is the maximum queue length, right? So still nobody is there in the queue. So I will write it as 0 only. Nobody is there in the queue. So 0, right? So next, come to the third step. Remove the imminent event from the list, advance the clock from T to T1. So I will be removing A, 3, right? So I will advance the clock from T to T1. That means 2 to 3 it will go, right? So at 3, what is happening? A, 3. A, 3 means arrival of the next customer is happening, right? So I will write that C2 has come, right? So C2 will come here. Server is free, right? So C2 will enter the server directly. So C2 has come. Who is there in the queue? Nobody is there in the queue. What is the status of the server? Server is busy, right? What type of event it is? Arrival event. So if it is arrival event, I have to schedule next arrival and next departure, right? But departure is already there. D, 8, E, 20. Always remember, you will have only 3 things here. Arrival, departure and end of the simulation. Already departure is there. So what I will schedule? I will schedule the next arrival. So go back, take your pencil, strike out the next arrival, which is A, 5 and command right here. Right, so you have to write it in ascending order. So A, 5, D, 8, E, 20. Right, so what did you do? Second arrival occurred, right, at A, 3. So A star is equal to 2. So A star is nothing but the inter arrival time of the third customer. What is the inter arrival time of the third customer? It is 2. Right, so come back. You will write A star is equal to 2, schedule next A. A star is equal to 2, schedule next A. Right, so then you have to calculate the busy time of the server, right? So 0 to 2 server was busy, right? So from 2 to 3 was what is the status of the server? Server was free, right? So 2 to 3 server was free because the next customer came at 3 only. Second customer arrival is at 3, whereas the first customer departure is at 2, right? So 2 to 3 the server was free, right? So that is why busy time of the server, I will keep it as it is as a 2, because the server was busy only for 2 minutes. Right, because 2 to 3 nobody was there, right, and the server was free. Here the server became free, right? So that is why you should not update your busy time of the server, right? So maximum queue length, who is there in the queue? Nobody is there in the queue, right? So again, we'll continue. Remove the imminent event from the list, advance the clock from T to T1, right? So I will advance the clock. I'll come here. It is 5. What has happened now? The next customer has come, right? So who is that customer? Third customer, right? So when will second customer go out? He will go out at 8, right? So third customer has come. So he will stand in the queue. So write C3, C2 dash, right? So once you have done this, how many people are there in the queue? One person is there in the queue, right? So one. What is the status of the server? The status of the server is it is busy. So I will write 1. What type of event it is? It is arrival event. So if it is arrival, I have to schedule the next arrival and departure, right? So already departure D, 20 is there. You have removed A, 5, right? So you will go and select the next arrival. So after A, 5, what is the next arrival? Next arrival is A, 11, right? So I will come here. I will write A, 11 again in ascending order. So what has happened? Third arrival occurred at A, 5. What is A star? A star is nothing but the next inter arrival time. So I will see the inter arrival time of the fourth customer, which is 6, right? So A star is equal to 6, schedule next A. Right, so now I have to calculate the busy time of the server, right? So to calculate the busy time of the server, you have to see the clock, right? So the current clock minus the previous clock, right? So what is the current clock time? Current clock is 5. What is the previous clock? Previous clock is 3. So 5 minus 3 is how much? 5 minus 3 is 2, right? That means the server was busy for 2 minutes. right? So already 2 is there. So for this 2, I will be adding the current 2. So 2 plus 2 is equal to 4. That means totally the server is busy for 4 minutes. I repeat, in order to calculate the busy time of the server, you have to take the current clock time minus the previous clock time. Current clock time minus the previous clock time. So 5 minus 3, you will get it as a 2. That means server was busy for 2 minutes, right? And since this is cumulative statistics, because we are calculating the total time when the server was busy, right? So that is why this 2, we have to add it to the previous value. Every time we'll be adding here. So 2 plus 2 is equal to 4. Right? What about the status of the queue? How many people are there in the queue now? One person is there in the queue. Right? So like this, we will be continuing our problem. Right? So then what we do, which is the next imminent event from the list? The imminent event in the list is a D comma 8. Right? So remove the imminent event from the list, advance the clock from T to T1. So D comma 8 means what? Departure of the second customer. So second customer will move out. Right. So since it is a departure event, I have to schedule the next departure. What is the next departure? After D comma 8, what we have? We have to go back and check here. After D comma 8, I have D comma 13. Right. So I have to strike out this. I have to take D comma 13 now. Right. So in MIFEL, I will write A comma 11, D comma 13, A comma 20. Right. So what has happened? Second D occur. Right. So see the service time. Service time of the third customer, right? So you'll go back and you will see the service time of the third customer. What is the service time of the third customer? It is 5, right? So S star is equal to 5, schedule the next D, right? So whichever schedule you have written, whichever departure you have written for that particular customer, you should go and see the service time, right? So once again, how to write the busy time of the server? Current clock minus the previous clock. So the previous clock was 5, right? So 8 minus 5 is how much? 8 minus 5 is 3, right? So server was busy. So 3 plus 4, I will get it as 7, right? So what's the maximum queue length? Maximum queue length is nothing but till how much the queue was updated. The queue was updated till 1, right? So I will continue it as 1. That means maximum the queue was filled by one person. That is what it means, right? So again, continue, remove the imminent event from the list, advance the clock from T to T1, right? 11, 11 is nothing but arrival of the fourth customer. So C4, C3 dash, right? So you have to write the illustration first. How many people are there in the queue? One person in the queue. How many with the server? One person with the server. What type of event it is? Arrival event, right? So if it is arrival, I have to schedule the next arrival and departure. Departure is already there. So I have scheduled the next arrival, right? So I will write fourth arrival occurs. A star is equal to 2, schedule next day, right? How to write the busy time of the server? Current clock time minus previous clock time. So 11 minus 8. 11 minus 8, I will get it as 3, right? So add that 3 to your 7, I will get 7 plus 3 is 10, right? So maximum queue is one person only. Again, continue, remove the imminent event from the list. So it is 13, you will remove 13. So what type of event it is? A departure event, right? So who will move out? Third customer will move out, right? So if third customer moves out, I have to write C4, right? So at 13, what is happening? Departure is also happening, arrival is happening, right? So departure of the third customer, arrival of the fifth customer, right? So that is why I will write C3 outside, C4 will go inside, and C5 will come and sit here. Right, so arrival and departure both has occurred, right? So I have to schedule the next arrival and next departure. So I will go and select after A comma 13 and D comma 13. What I have here in my list, A comma 13, D comma 13 is over, means I have D comma 21 and A comma 17, right? So I will write A comma 17, E comma 20 and D comma 21. Always remember, you have to write it in ascending order. So A comma 17, E comma 20, D comma 21 is what you write, right? So what has happened? Just update the comment, right? As I have said, so what is the current clock time? 13. Previous clock time is 11. 13 minus 11 is how much? It is a 2, right? So server was busy, right? So that is why 10 plus 2, it is equal to 12. Maximum queue length is 1 only, right? So now remove the imminent event from the list. It is advance the clock from T to T1. I will get 17. At 17, what is happening? One more customer is coming, right? So A comma 17. A comma 17 is nothing but arrival of which customer? Arrival of sixth customer, A comma 17, right? So C4 is still there with the system, right? So C6 comma C5, two people are there in the queue. So write the illustration, command update here. Here it should be 2, right? How many people are there in the queue? Right, sorry, LQ of T. LQ of T is nothing but, is there anybody in the queue? Yes, people are there in the queue. So the status is 1, right? So it is not number of people in the queue. LQ is nothing but whether the queue is free or whether the queue is busy, right? So whether the queue is empty or whether the queue, somebody is there in the queue, right? So here two people are there in the queue. That means what is the status of the queue? Queue is somebody is there in the queue. So queue is 1. What about status of the server? Server is busy, right? So now what type of event has occurred? It is an arrival event. So if it is arrival event, I have to schedule the next arrival and departure. Already departure is there, so I'll schedule the next arrival. What is the next arrival after A comma 21, right? So after A comma 17, next arrival is A comma 22, right? So I will write A comma 22, right? So if I write it in ascending order, I will get it as E comma 20, D comma 21, and A comma 22, right? So 60 has occurred, right? So what is the current busy time? 17 minus 13. 17 minus 13 is 4. 12 plus 4 is 16. Busy time of the server is 16. What is the maximum queue length? Two people are there in the queue. So I will write it as maximum queue length is 2. Right. So next, remove the imminent event from the list. Advance the clock from T to T1. So E comma 20. You will write 20. It is end of the simulation. Right. So in order to come to know the end of the simulation, you have to write this in ascending order. Once you come here, it is end. What are the previous values? Previous values of the busy time and maximum queue length, that will be the busy time of the server. So busy time of the server is 16 and maximum queue length is 2, right? So in order to calculate the server utilization, the formula is total server busy time divided by total runtime of simulation into 100. Total busy time of the server is how much? This is the last value, because every time we were adding in every step, that is why we take the last value as the total busy time. So total busy time is 16. 16 divided by total runtime of simulation is 20 into 100. So 16 by 20 into 100, if I do, I will get it as 80%, right? So that means 80% of server is utilized. And what is the maximum queue length? Maximum queue length is 2, right? So like that, you have to solve the problem, right? So this is the first type where you are calculating the busy time of the server and the maximum queue length, right? So in the tomorrow session, let us see about how to solve the problems on checkout line. That means to find the number of departures, to find the number of customers who have spent 5 or more minutes or 4 or more minutes, and how to calculate the average response time.